I'd like to welcome Dr. Maria Santos to Cal State San Bernardino. Dr. Santos received her PhD in clinical psychology from the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee. She did her doctoral internship at the consortium, psychology consortium at the University of New Mexico as part of the consortium, as I mentioned, but also as part of the Veterans Administration hospital system, as well as the University of New Mexico Hospital. Most recently, Dr. Santos is a postdoc at the USC in the I say Department of Culture and Mental Health. Am I right about that?
Department of Psychology and Lab of and Culture and Mental
Health. Lab of, and Culture of Culture and Mental Health, where she'll talk to us today about research on optimizing the engagement of Latinos. And let's give her a warm coyote welcome.
Thank you very much for having me. I think it's been a real pleasure getting to know everybody, and I am excited to share about my work, and yeah, I hope you find this useful. Okay, so I'll go ahead and get started then. So today my objectives are to talk about an area of public health concern that is really at the core of my work. I also want to talk about findings that I've done primarily in the area of depression treatment for Latinos in a way that relates to this issue of engagement. And I also want to talk to you about areas of future study that, again, are focused on improving this issue, in particular for groups that are at high risk for engagement and that are at high risk of being negatively impacted in the long term due to issues of disengagement. So what we know from data from the National Comorbidity Study Replication is that most people with mental illness underutilize mental health services. And what we also know from this epidemiological data set is that almost 20% of people who are in need of mental health services actually terminate treatment before their recommended treatment course is done. Engagement issues have been highlighted in reports that document the mental health disparities that impact the racial and ethnic minorities in our country that were produced in the early 2000s. So this issue of engagement has been highlighted for these groups. In more recent work, we have found that this issue of engagement continues to be prominent in our U.S. systems of care. Our systems of care continue to be pretty ineffective at engaging in treatment members of these populations. One group that is among those affected by issues of engagement are Latinos, and I know the crowd. We all know who Latinos are of Latin American origin, comprised in 2015, according to the Pew Hispanic Research Center, of 56.5 million individuals. And according to the Public Policy Institute of California, Latinos are comprised of the largest group of immigrants, something we're taking in mind as we move forward. So for the last 20 years, what epidemiologists have been documenting is that this issue of Latino service use. What they have been noticing for the last 20 years is that those individuals of Mexican origin use services at low rates, with those individuals who are immigrants actually using services at lower rates than those individuals who are U.S. born. And the same was found by another group. The first group was Vega et al., and the second group was Alegría. 8 years later, documented that similar things with English-speaking counterpart Latinos actually engaging in service rates more so than those who are Spanish-speaking immigrants. So if we take a closer look into the present and in California specifically, we continue to see this. So what we see here are our data on penetration rates. And so important to keep in mind is what we're seeing here are individuals who have a means of paying for services because they have public-sponsored health coverage. And so out of these individuals who have public-sponsored health coverage, we see that Latinos are using services at lower rates than their African-American counterparts, as well as whites. And this is in particular here for fiscal year 2015-2016 for children, youth, and families. We see the same pattern when we look at adults that include older adults, with this population here, a subgroup, using services even less than their Asian and Pacific Islander counterparts. When we move somewhere else in California to the Imperial Valley, we see the same trend, where here, as you can see, the populations are categorized by language use. Still, for both fiscal years, 2015-2016, 2016-2017, we see lower rates of service use among Spanish-speaking and among English-speaking. So, what is it that I've learned that it relates to this issue of engagement? So my interest in this topic first came about when I was working in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. I was part of a research team with the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee and collaborators at the 16th Street Mental Health Center. And the idea was to try to help these professionals in the community meet the needs of the Latino population. And so there was a needs assessment had, and what really came across is that the number one issue for these administrators and for the clients was helping to improve this client engagement at the downstream engagement. So not in terms of access, but in terms of staying in care. Because most people were staying in services for only one session. So what our group thought was, what about addressing this issue of engagement with BA, behavioral activation? So what is BA? So as some of you guys, or some of you here may know, BA is a well-established, empirically validated treatment for depression, according to the American Psychological Association Division 12 Task Force. And it is a treatment that is very straightforward, that is purported to function through activation, or what, just to give meaning to that term, meaningful engagement in life, with the ultimate goal of helping individuals meet their needs and also live a life of meaning. But why is it that our group thought that BA might be a good fit for Latino communities? Well, for one, it could be implemented such that engagement was a primary focus of treatment. It could also be implemented rather easily. So one of the benefits of BA in comparison to other treatments is that it is easy to understand, easy to pick up on the therapist end and on the client end. A therapist can, in a community mental health setting where there is very limited time and to be able to pick up treatments, could pick this treatment up with the limited time that they have. And it benefits therapists also in that they are able to impart something to their clients that is effective and quick to pick up. And as I said before, people don't stay in treatment, so this is a particularly important issue to address when we're thinking about treatments to transport to the community. It's also flexible with regard to culture. So what do I mean by flexible with regard to culture? Well, at the core of a BA is scheduling meaningful activities so that the person is able to live that life of meaning. But how is it that we identify activities that are meaningful? Well, we do that through values assessments. We do that either by listening attentively to the client's narrative to capture what matters, or you can use a structured way values assessment form. So through doing this value assessment, you really get at what matters, which is at the core of a dynamic definition of culture that says that what matters actually encapsulates a culture because it's grounded in a person's local social world. So I think I've made this clear that through this values process, a person is able to access what matters or culture. And so the treatment actually considers people's cultural perspectives. I've been asked about this values assessment, so I thought I would share in explaining how BA accesses what matters very briefly. What it entails is identifying life domains that are important to a person. Like, what areas of your life really speak to you right now as areas where you need some change? A person might say family relationships. The goal then of the therapist and the client is to then from there formulate some concrete statements of value that really can guide action, some behavior. So in this instance, it would be, I value being an available son. And so the action statement might be, I will help my parents manage their bills. So this is the way in which BA accesses what matters in the sensitive to culture. So given these points, as you recall, the ability to target engagement, as well as the ease of implementation and this flexibility with regard to culture, our group decided to test BA. And given some promising results out of a pilot trial, we went ahead and did just that, where we compared BA to treatment as usual for depression. In the community, and that included in moving forward things like processing childhood experiences, processing emotion. I'll show you where we got that from later. But so we did this comparison through an NIMH-funded trial, and important to keep in mind is the population we were working with. It was very reflective of the Latino population in Wisconsin. So, it actually represented the Latino population nationally. So in Wisconsin, about 65% of the Latino population is of Mexican origin, and a little over 16%, at least at the time of the study, was of Puerto Rican origin. And so our sample closely approximated that. It certainly was very comparable to the population that received services at the clinic. And so the people in our study were not different actually from the actual clientele. So you can see here that our sample was comprised of 21 individuals in the BA condition and 22 in the treatment as usual condition. Important to keep in mind is that we didn't find any differences in terms of demographic characteristics, clinical characteristics, or randomization variables. Primarily women, about 39 years of age, born in Mexico. So in this trial, we did assessments where the raters were blind to condition. We assigned people to the conditions after that and offered individuals up to 12 sessions of psychotherapy treatment at the clinic. Today I'm going to be reporting on the post-treatment data. So of course a question that we have to ask always is, were the therapists able to execute this treatment with fidelity to the manual? And what we found based on two measures is that they, in fact, they were able to. So we used one observer-rated measure where the rater was blind to condition, and rater reliability was achieved with two other raters. And then another one was a checklist that the therapist used to report what it is that they did. And so we find that these converge, again, with VA therapists doing VA and treatment as usual therapists doing something other than VA, because of course you want to check for leakage. And so this is what we consider to be our main finding, where, as you can see here, with regard to engagement, the VA therapists were able to retain their clients in treatment for much longer, where this is depicts the cases in the study per condition. So we see that they're clustered at 8 to 12, and that certainly doesn't look the case here with the treatment as usual condition, where individuals are really clustered here around 0 to 4. Okay, and so as you see here, VA therapists were actually attending a little under 4 more sessions than were the treatment as usual, and it's not a negligible difference. So, of course, another question besides engagement was, were we able to successfully reduce depression symptoms in the community with this treatment? And we conducted a three-way interaction considering sessions completed, treatment group, and time. And we found that the subgroup that experienced a meaningful reduction in depression was the group of VA individuals who attended a 9 to 12 sessions. This was the group who experienced a statistically significant reduction in their symptoms. Those findings we observed with the Hamilton Depression Rating Scale, which is an observer used measure, so a clinician-based measure. We also used the BDI, which is a self-report measure. This three-way interaction wasn't observed, but we did observe that when we plot out each case, we see the pattern reflected on the self-report measure. So what we have here, again, as I said, is each individual in each of the conditions, in both of the conditions, plotted out by people who attended 0 to 4 sessions, 5 to 8 sessions, and 9 to 12 sessions. And consistent with the Hamilton findings, we see that for this group here, who attended 9 to 12 sessions, we see a pattern, a downward trend in depression, except for this individual here. So as you gather, higher numbers here reflect a greater depression severity, and lower here, and you see it going down by the time that we reach these higher numbers. Okay. As you can see in the treatment as usual condition, there's no real discernible pattern with this person kind of staying pretty high, experiencing a dip, but, you know, kind of coming back up. So the convergence of these two depression results made us consider that we're finding a real improvement here. Another reason why we felt that there was a meaningful improvement for this subgroup of the sample is that these are also the only people who experienced some improvement in terms of mental health functioning and also quality of life. So we took away that it's viable to implement this treatment in the community well, because the therapists are able to implement it with fidelity. And also that these therapists who are trained to do this are able to successfully engage their clients in treatment more successfully than the treatment as usual condition. And I should mention that this is actually a replicated finding in the pilot trial where there wasn't an actual comparison condition, still the VA clients were maintained in therapy for as long as they were in this trial. And as I mentioned, the treatment as usual was attending one session with that intervention. So this makes us wonder, can VA be used to better engage individuals who might need intervention for this issue even more so, given the chronicity, the risk of long-term chronicity in their illness? So we became curious to know whether engagement depended on client cultural characteristics. And so we examined cultural moderators of engagement. In particular, we were interested in knowing whether BA was better at engaging some clients better than others, given these characteristics. And because we were wanting to know whether the BA protocol required modification in order to be more sensitive to the needs of a subset of population. So we asked this question about whether cultural factors moderate the engagement treatment, treatment-engagement relationship while controlling for pre-treatment depression. And we used the whole sample for this study, where our outcomes were number of sessions attended, controlled for the pre-treatment depression using the BEI-2, and we examined acculturation, familism, and acculturative stress to see if they moderated this. Given the results of our study, I will focus on one particular variable, and that is acculturative stress. We use the multidimensional acculturative stress inventory to examine this, which contains four dimensions. As you can see here, this is bolded. I'd like you to pay particular attention for this in order to better interpret the findings. So individuals who are experiencing this pressure against acculturation are experiencing distress, conflict, or criticism from others for preferring American over Latino customs. And we conducted a series of hierarchical multiple regressions to examine this question. So before we get going, I thought it might be useful to help you understand what it is that the therapists were providing or usually provide to their clients. And briefly here, we see that, as I said before, emotional experiencing was something that the treatment as usual therapists were doing more than VA, cognitive restructuring. And these are some other things that they were doing that were also the VA therapists were providing empathy, we hope. And validation. So the model, when we entered the interaction term for pressure against acculturation, in the model we reached significance. And so we took a look at the unstandardized coefficients in order to detect what was driving this finding. And we found that, in fact, it was the interaction term which lets us know that it's pressure against acculturation. But what does this look like, actually? And so what we found is that among those people who were experiencing not a whole lot of distress, conflict, criticism because of pressure against acculturation, those people were attending a comparable number of sessions. So condition not playing a role. But what we found is that among those individuals who were experiencing an average level of distress, we found that those individuals were actually attending sessions less than those who had lower pressure, almost four sessions less. And among those individuals with high pressure, even fewer sessions. So it seems that pressure against acculturation may moderate the relationship between treatment and engagement for the treatment as usual condition, where those clients being treated with the usual care may be expected to actually attend fewer sessions if they're experiencing average to high levels of this pressure. So it might suggest that treatment as usual therapists in the community may need to be aware of the presence of this phenomena and address it so that session attendance isn't affected. So BA clients were attending number of sessions well across the board, or were not being impacted by this distress. And we find that all BA clients in general might be expected to attend more sessions than their TAU counterparts with average time pressure. Why we're finding this is unclear. This is not something that we can investigate, unfortunately, with this available data, but we can speculate. It could be that BA addresses any issue arising from pressure against acculturation, given that BA is really focused on addressing any contextual factor, any factor in the client's life that could interfere with engagement and treatment. It also may simply just not exacerbate something that's there, remains unclear. Our interest was in determining whether the data supported any modification to the treatment, and these findings don't suggest that. As far as we know, this is the first study, at least at the time, that was looking at cultural moderators of this treatment engagement relationship. So what do we know about BA and engagement? It seems like BA is engaging individuals in care successfully than the usual care provided, at least in this community. We also know that is not dependent on any cultural characteristics at least the ones we measured, or the data suggests that it's not anyway. So then, so the question becomes, how is it that BA is actually affecting this benefit? Could it be activation? I mean, one of the things to remember is that the BA therapists, but not the treatment as usual therapists, were using activation strategies. They were focused on activity scheduling and anything that supports that, but not the treatment as usual therapists. We also know that BA therapists were actually trying to engage through activation their clients, so it could be. So what we know very little about how BA actually works. In general, we don't know very much about how our treatments work. BA is no exception, and there hasn't been a whole lot of work looking at BA's purported mechanism of change, activation. And this is unfortunate, given that it has the potential of really helping us to improve our treatments and making them more efficacious. Yes. And we have the potential of increasing their pragmatism. So if we know that activation is really what's driving change, then maybe we don't need some treatment strategies that are not facilitating that process. So we use session by session data in order to examine whether activation is a mechanism of change for BA. So we used these two measures, the BDI-2 as well as the behavioral activation for depression scale short form. I'm just going to call it the behavioral activation scale. And we used a subset of clients that we see here because those are the clients that had the sufficient data points to be able to look at this process variable. So individuals had to have 5 data points in order to be able to do these analyses. And a thing to keep in mind is that whereas BA protected, well, an important thing to keep in mind is that behavioral activation for Latinos was designed to protect the core component activity scheduling, which is thought to really drive change through activation. And this core component is not present in Latino. So what is behavioral activation according to this behavioral activation measure? So that we have 4 examples here. So a person who would be activated is somebody who would be doing the things that they need to do. So they would be saying that they're not really doing much of this here. There are certain things I did that I didn't do. They would be scoring high on this item. I was an active person and accomplished the goals I set out to do. They would score high, reflecting more activation. So before I go into our results, I thought that it might be helpful to go over kind of what kind of relationship between activation and depression we would need to see in order to establish a mechanism. And so what we have here are some hypothetical data, and this is the data for one individual over the course of a 12 session treatment of BA. We see that they completed behavioral activation and depression measures throughout the course of treatment, though there are no missing spaces here in these lines. So given the theory of BA that says that when a person is more depressed, they are less activated or engaged in their life, then we would expect what we see at session 1 here, where the person is showing about a 15 on activation and are showing pretty severe depression up here. Okay, so this is consistent with BA theory. Again, we would expect less engagement in life, more severe depression. So here this person also shows a trajectory of these 2 variables in a way that is consistent with BA theory, where we would expect BA, or engagement in life, excuse me, to be going up. So here the person had a bit of a dip, but overall the trajectory is that it's going up. And given that that's going up, we would expect this with depression, where it went down throughout treatment. Okay. So, but it's not sufficient to see this pattern in BA treatment to be able to say that a mechanism is, that a variable is it seems to be a mechanism. What we need to see in particular is a specific temporal relationship, where we need to see that change in the potential mechanism variable, activation in this case, is actually changes happening before in time any change in depression. So we set out to examine precisely that temporal relationship. Does it exist in these treatments? And we did that by computing cross-lagged correlations. So these are correlations that represent I'm going to explain it in the future here, but before I do that, what we did was look to see whether activation predicted a depression . So we did this one to see whether activation at a given session predicted depression at the next session. So what the cross-lagged correlations represent is a pattern where activation at one session predicts depression at the next session, aggregated over all of those available data points. And so it's a measure of autocorrelation. I thought I would just put that out there. I included this chart here because I just want to point out these two pairs of data, where you see a relationship that is consistent with this pattern, where a client at session two reports a rise in activation that predicted a decrease in depression reported at session three. And here, a decrease in activation reported at session six predicted an increase in depression at session seven. We also computed lag zero correlations, which is just looking at the relationship between activation and depression during the same window of time. We were just interested in seeing whether during the same window of time we were seeing a relationship between these two variables that was consistent with BA theory, which, as I've said before, activation should be going up, depression should be going down, or vice versa. We also computed another lag, cross-lagged correlation, lag negative one. The reason is that we were curious to see if the data didn't support the theory, the hypothesis that BA puts forth, that activation goes up and then depression goes down. An alternative hypothesis would be that depression goes up and then depression goes down. So that the reason that there's any relationship between activation and depression is actually that people feel better and then they get more engaged in life. So this is why we computed this type of cross-lagged correlation. So this is what we find, that when we're thinking just about the lag one, so activation predicts depression, we see that BA clients, six BA clients actually evidence this temporal pattern. But none of the TAU ones did. And what we also find is that when we're thinking just about during the same window of time, does activation go up and depression go down, you know, at the same report, or, you know, depression up, activation down, we find that the BA clients, 10 of the 14, are showed this pattern. We should keep in mind that five of these people are the same five up here. We also found in two cases some support for the alternative, which isn't problematic for BA theory from my perspective. Of course, there, you know, some people who feel better are going to get more engaged, you know. What we hope to see is that the other relationship is pretty dominant in BA treatment. So two people showed that they felt better and they got engaged. So is activation a plausible mechanism of change? From our perspective, it could be in 72% of these cases, where at least for six of these clients, there is a pretty clear relation, support for the notion that activation kind of changed first and then led to the improvement. So, but the question still remains, we still need to examine whether activation for the subset of clients, for instance, who, you know, showed significant concurrent correlations, they might be showing a significant negative relationship with activation and depression, but not because activation came first. It could be that if we take a closer look at these individuals, that will find that actually depression came first, you know? So what I'm saying is that we need to ask this question looking at a shorter windows of time. And if those results were to be consistent with ours, then we might have more confidence in the idea that activation is a mechanism of change in VA. So for me, the question is, does activation also lead to other outcomes that impact a client's well-being, such as successful engagement in therapy? So we found this benefit of VA. We don't know how it's happening quite yet, but it seems like it could be beneficial to consider this treatment for, again, high-risk groups. And high-risk groups, in my mind, are people that if they don't remain engaged, can be very seriously affected by not remaining engaged. And those are individuals who are at risk for chronic illness if they don't engage. So what about individuals with psychotic spectrum disorders? So, as many of you may know, there's a really high cost in the lives and families of individuals who are impacted by the onset of psychosis. It causes havoc, and then individuals can't very well, or sometimes not at all, meet their basic needs, and are not able to lead a life of meaning, fulfillment. VA is designed to target precisely these things. So it seems to map on conceptually. But can VA help individuals with psychosis live a life of meaning by targeting what's at stake or what matters to them in terms of recovery? So my colleagues and I examined what's at stake for individuals with serious mental illness and their families. We did this by examining their views about the future, in particular, individuals with schizophrenia and their primary caregivers. We didn't only seek to examine what's at stake or what matters to these individuals with serious mental illness and their families, we also wanted to see, are what matters to them congruent? Part of our goal was to access what participants' cultural perspectives on recovery were, given our definition that culture is what matters in the global social worlds. So we asked, thinking about the future, what do you want for yourself? What do you want for your relative? And we developed a coding system based on the recovery literature and shaped by the data. And just briefly, so these are some of the recovery categories that are said to be key for recovery. One of them being independence. Individuals want to be able to fulfill everyday responsibilities, things that are basic like paying bills that can be very rewarding. Not a lot for some of us, but you know, we get a lot of reward from that. Also, social relationships, another one. Want to have romantic relationships, want to have a partner, even just somebody to chat. Another category that we ended up throwing in there, not throwing in it haphazardly, but we ended up including is this recovery, because it kept coming up in the data, and we'll talk more about it later. Just these expressions of, well, I want well-being for them. So what did we find? Well, actually not quite yet. We achieved an iterator agreement. And individuals who have had schizophrenia in this sample tended to be male in their higher 30s, born in the US, whereas caregivers were mostly female. It's not up here, but the caregivers tended to be, as one might expect, mothers and other important female figures in people's lives, like sisters, and also partners. What we found is that in general, both consumers and caregivers really wanted things like independence for the person with schizophrenia, but there was a different pattern in that, whereas consumers, what I call consumers, people with serious mental illness like schizophrenia, wanted was independence overwhelmingly, whereas their caregivers really just wanted improvement. We couldn't examine what this recovery, these general statements meant, but it seemed like just well-being. If we look at what people were actually saying, we see in this case that individuals with schizophrenia with regard to independence were saying, I want to have the American dream, have a job, house, bills. Or my long-term goal is to study computing, make my life for myself, have a partner, look for work, or a social relationship, where we see the independence coming out. Whereas caregivers were saying things like, I want her to be a normal person. I want him to get ahead. I want him to feel the best that he can, basically, that he lead as normal life as possible. So the question was originally, can VA address what's at stake? What really matters to individuals? So what matters to individuals, like I said, is a little different, and treatment should be able to get at what's at stake for both individuals with schizophrenia and families. For those of you who don't know, indicated treatment for schizophrenia involves inclusion out of the family. VA can meet this challenge in that if what's at stake for an individual with schizophrenia is being more independent, the goal could be looking for a job. And if to meet what's at stake, what matters to a caregiver, a VA therapist could propose focusing on treatment adherence. So it seems that VA might be a useful tool for individuals with serious mental illness. In particular, I'm interested in individuals with first episode psychosis. We know that the literature shows that early intervention attenuates the impact of serious psychosis. We know that if individuals go longer than about a year without engaging well after onset, that their prognosis looks worse. Unfortunately, though, 30% of individuals with first episode psychosis disengage from services prematurely, and this is early intervention. So I think that VA might have some benefits over what we have seen as a gold standard treatment for first episode psychosis with a focus on engagement. Multi-component interventions that are massively expensive and difficult to implement in the community have successfully been shown to engage individuals in care relative to usual care. But the drawback, as implied in the way I said that, is that it might not be feasible for use in the community setting where there are really limited resources. So VA may be superior with respect to feasibility. I've stressed before that it's pretty easy to pick up. And it is a low resource intervention according to the World Health Organization. So in thinking about the future, and what I'm excited about now is the idea of testing VA to target engagement to see if compared to usual care offered in the community, it is more successful at engaging. I also seek to continue to better understand some predictors of engagement as well as disengagement. What are therapists, VA therapists, doing in the therapy session that may be associated with these factors and maybe predict predicting. I'm also interested in some client behaviors that reflect engagement and disengagement and are associated with either dropout or treatment continuity. We don't really, all of our measures of engagement are really number of sessions attended, dropout status, treatment non-adherence. But by that point, it's kind of late to intervene. They're not really useful outcome measures. What we need, really, is to know upstream what's happening in the therapy room that is leading to these outcomes. And I hope that this can help us give shape to some brief interventions. I'm thinking based on VA, if not VA, mini package, that could be used with other interventions to be able to target this issue. So we need to address this issue of engagement to address disparities. We have good treatments, we know that there are so many now, but what's the point if we can't keep people in care? We don't have an opportunity to implement these treatments. We need to consider a client's culture in trying to tackle this issue. I think that BA holds promise for meeting these goals, and I'm excited to find that out. Thank you.
I have a question.
Yes.
It was going back to the study where you looked at treatment as usual versus BA.
Yes.
And found the moderation effect for
yes. with the
cultural acculturation scale.
Yeah.
I thought that was an interesting finding. Mm-hmm. Perhaps actually an extra argument for BA as a treatment to enhance engagement. There's the TA. So, you know, the only acculturation variable was this pressure against acculturation. So this, and if I read that right, this is sort of experiencing around them, family, friends, to keep the traditional practices, not to become too gringo if it's Mexican or whatever. And so it made sense to me that TAU, and if you go to the slide now where you showed what's in TAU, emotional experiencing, exploring your childhood, although number four I think would be consistent with tradition,
mm-hmm.
but the first two are very Western ideas. And so I think that it, to me, it runs right into the face of what they're struggling with, which is this idea of keeping the traditions and throwing a very Western idea of therapy at them.
Mm-hmm.
It's a clash. I can imagine somebody saying, enough of this therapy, I'm dealing with this at home to not acculturate and to keep the traditions, and you're throwing this therapy at me where I'm exploring childhood. And it may just be too much of a clash of different cultures. Wherein BA, what's nice about it is it's more collaborative in choosing what's important to them. It's more, as you say, simple, but I think structured
mm-hmm.
in terms of choosing what's important to them, can be consistent with their culture and desires, and not, so something they're willing to hang in there longer. Because
mm-hmm.
I'm not even talking about outcomes here, but just hanging in there longer. So it's not surprising to me that you saw less sessions. And I'm not sure if that's how you guys were interpreting it.
Yeah.
How were you guys
actually, I think that's interesting, and I'd be curious to see whether there's, because these were collected using the fidelity forms I shared about, and they were administered at each session. So we have a lot of that data. I guess what I'm getting at is I just wonder if would pick up any association between these things and the number of sessions attended. But no, we weren't thinking about it along those I guess, even in my, even though I'm like Latina, not that I'm like a spokesperson for all Latinos, you know, but like I hadn't seen that as like contrary to like dominant culture, like, you know, so, but that's interesting. And we do, I guess, have, could maybe examine any association with like the specific thing. I'm not sure how, of like, at what the base of use of these things, you know, but
and just one follow up, there actually was a manual for TAU.
Oh, no, you're asking me, sorry.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, there was not, because we wanted it to be that is ecologically, you know, what is actually happening in the community.
Okay.
Yes.
Do we know whether or not the participants in your first study, study that we're talking about here, were also receiving any drug treatment for their depression?
Yes. Some people were receiving drug treatment. We wanted to not interfere with the care that was indicated according to the providers. So in some cases, but after the start of the treatment, yes.
And there's no reason to expect that that varied from one group to the other, between the BA group and the TAU group.
I will be completely honest with you. I will have to look at that, but I don't recall that ever being the thing that we contended with.
I guess another question, different question. So I'm wondering about the TAU, the traditional, the treatment as usual strategies group. You've got a description there of aspects of that, but is it possible that, I guess, is it possible that that group essentially really is just like a bad therapy group?
In other words,
you know, we know that mental health services in our so-called minority communities are not always the best, whether it's in terms of therapist competence, or in terms of a variety of things of delivering quality health care. So I'm just wondering if there's any possibility that part of the effect, and it would probably just be a small part, but part of the effect might be something along those lines.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, of course, we have no way of assessing the competence of these therapists. We have a comparison group and those data to kind of look into that. But I think it's an important question, and it speaks to, I guess, the generalizability of findings, you know, because obviously treatment, as usual, will look different from place to place. I can only speak on the impression that we had, which is really not really useful, I suppose, you know.
But the therapists using BA weren't like systematically different, for they weren't like
So that's what you're right. Yeah. Good question. Yeah. So. They had very different backgrounds.
Yeah.
We couldn't like match them on some characteristics, but that would have led to you know, controlling for that. Maybe the VA therapists are super awesome, you know, and it's kind of some kind of that kind of is playing a role in our findings. No differences that I can speak.
Thank you.
Did you control for ethnic background between the two of the therapists?
Right.
So just kind of curious on that, if there are differences between those two groups.
Right. I can tell you that there were four therapists in each condition. Three therapists in both conditions were of a Latino origin, different national origins. And in each group, there was the one person who was non-Hispanic white. I'm trying to think of their backgrounds right now. In both conditions, there was a PhD level psychologist. And then the rest were about master's level. I think there was an LPC, an escapes licensed. But Yeah, so based on those things, they seem comparable in terms of like number of years of education and stuff like that.
Just staying on then I had a, the original question. So these are from that clinic that you were describing earlier today, right?
Yes.
So I guess my assumption would be, at least in terms of the selection process, a therapist, that if that's a place that's intended to provide good quality service to Latinos, that the therapist that they select would be fairly comparable to each other.
Well, they prided themselves, yeah.
Right.
Yes.
So, I guess my question was, in terms of the future research, I was intrigued by, you're talking about client factors that might be predictive of engagement, disengagement. What sorts of things are you thinking about with regard to that?
Yeah, I mean, I would imagine that things like compliance with homework might be a predictor of eventual disengagement, for instance. That's something that I can confidently think about right now. I mean, completion, which goes along the same lines, completion of any self-report, maybe even the number of times that people cancel, you know, as a reflection of disengagement. I'm more interested in an area that I haven't kind of done work in before, which is more of like, but this is not really objective, but I'm gonna try to keep an open mind. But like, maybe eye contact, you know? Like, are they connecting, you know, in their relationship? Or is like the client looking at the floor the whole time? Mm-hmm. I'm thinking of one client I had when I was training who eventually dropped out, who would just seem totally disconnected from me. And I mean, it was no surprise that he eventually mm-hmm. dropped out. So so that's behavioral things, mm-hmm. I guess, some of which can be pretty specifically, concretely outlined.
Mm-hmm. You think there's more promise with the acculturation?
I think we need to continue to look at that. I mean, our N was small, as you said. I mean, it was the one subdomain, you know, so we need to replicate that finding to feel some confidence in this. But definitely we need to continue looking at it, because the literature is replete with these references to cultural variables being important for engagement. But there isn't a whole lot of work looking at whether, in fact, these factors seem to be important for things like engagement. So yes, I think that's something that I'd be interested in. Something that would be part of the like assessment tools to do in another trial.
Any more questions? Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.